Slides today. I have to apologize. You've been very patient. In fact, I'm going to suggest that everyone stand up. Because when I stood up, I had kind of a rush. having been sitting for so long, I want you to enjoy the rush. This will be the rush of blood flowing through your body. And give a little stretch. Open those lungs. It's a pleasure to be here. You can sit down now. Let's not overdo it. One of the advantages of not using PowerPoint slides, and I come from a school of education, and I've been a school teacher, and I'm used to talking to students. And so I just want to promote the notion that without PowerPoint slides, there's kind of a direct intimacy. I will use some statistics for those of you who are missing that, and others who feel a need can use the screen as a break. But for those of you doing your email, this will be a relief, because there'll be no need to look up. I am John Wolinski, and I am from Stanford University, but I'm in charge of, or I've been working with for 10 years now, the Public Knowledge Project. And I want to talk to you about the Public Knowledge Project as a platform, as a basis for publishing. And I want to do it as a kind of summative, because I feel, as the last speaker, I have a kind of responsibility to bring things together a bit, to kind of sum things up for those of you who haven't been paying attention entirely. And the two themes, and I kind of realize this is a dangerous moment for me, because I realize that the two themes today, or at least this afternoon, the two themes are quality, the quality and assurance and trust that marks a journal. And the second thing is the sustainability. I don't know if, do you remember? Yes, this term has come up more than once. All right? And in both of those, I am the problem. The Public Knowledge Project is the problem. The work that I do with open source software supporting journals, largely independent scholars or scholarly publishers, is part of the problem, because we've made it cheaper, we've made it easier to publish. And in that sense, we may have undermined the notion that you need a sustainability plan before you venture forth, that you may get that glint of academic freedom in your eye and start a journal without a business plan. Now, forgive me being at the end of the day to take advantage of a few things, a little bit of historical perspective, a chance to sit and think about some of these talks, because the talk about sustainability to me is so 2007. But my father thought of General Motors as the rock of sustainability. Untouchable. What was good for General Motors surely was good for the United States. But what happened? All right, this idea that we have a business model in hand needs to stand in contrast to the town we're in. I do hope you get a chance to get into the town. This isn't the whole of Lund. I don't know if you know that. Because in the town is a university that has been there for centuries without a sustainability plan, has been there for centuries by privilege of the Swedish government, by the patronage of the Swedish people. And that has sustained the scholarly endeavor. And my faith still lies with that notion, medieval as it is, of patronage and privilege, of the scholar's role as something that will be protected. And so I want to describe to you what the Public Knowledge Project has foolishly, I now realize, has foolishly gone ahead and done, because I don't have a business plan, I'm afraid. And the journals that we work with, most of them don't have a business plan. But they do have an economy, they do have a commitment, they are interested in quality, but they're not starting from a position of guarantees or assurances. They're starting from a position of freedom and risk around what it is to be a scholar, what it is to publish something, what it is to get involved in journal publishing. So I want to speak on behalf of the independent and scholarly publishers, scholar publishers. We're all scholarly publishers, surely. But on behalf of the scholar publishers, it's a new term to me, surely. And this notion of a platform. Because I do see a similarity between the platform in terms of the technology that we use and the kind of structures and infrastructures that the university in this town represents. ancient, decrepit in some ways, but always charming, full of life, not good for bicycles. Those cobblestones, what happens to your bicycles? I borrowed one. It was ridiculous. But at any rate, let me stay on topic. Two things that I want to pick up on from Peter's talk, and certainly a number of the talks today came back to these themes. The first, though, just in financial and the sustainability, is the sense that there is already enough money on the table. The position we need to take is no new money. The position we need to take is we can do things differently. We can rethink the balance among profit and non-profit, among scholarly volunteers and professional publishers. We can rethink the allocation of resources. But this isn't about finding new money. And I thought the point was brought home, and I'd like to end it with that notion as well. The second thing, however, is the gardener's model. There were two that Peter set up, the gardeners and the activists. It's kind of an interesting sensibility because many gardeners are activists. The whole organic movement, I take as a tribute to gardening. But at any rate, there's a third sense, and that is the degree to which we are researchers and scholars experimenting with our scholarly publications. That there is a sense in which every journal is an experiment, whether it's in the topic and its conception, whether it's in the work that it invites, whether it's in ideas like open data and different forms of delivery. And that we need to see, not just the scholar publishers, but all of us need to see that part of our role is to contribute, in the sense that Peter laid out around data sharing for sure, but to contribute to that sense of experiment. And that part of the sustainability language is that you are contributing to the ongoing experiment in scholarly communication. When we talk about the independent scholar, we have to go back to Henry Oldenburg and to that lovely slide of the Philosophical Transactions. Henry Oldenburg was an independent scholar publisher. The Royal Society would have nothing to do with it. They allowed their printer to be used. They allowed their minutes to be published. But they let Henry run off and publish the materials as he saw fit, as he transcribed them in the meetings of the Philosophical Society. And it was an experiment. Think about his business plan. I want to publish a scientific journal. There is no such thing. What is this thing? I'm going to publish it every month. No one has ever bought one before. And he thought he would make £50 a year from the philosophical. That was his plan because he wasn't being paid by the Royal Society. £50 a year. And of course, he complains in a letter that the printers took it all. Sound familiar? Things change. Things stay the same. So this idea then of how we begin to experiment, and 10 years ago the Public Knowledge Project came together, at least I had this idea that we would do something in terms of electronic publishing, that we would see a way to make a difference. The question I had been asked as a researcher is how much does it cost to put a journal online? My answer was, I don't know. We did some research, we found out it was between $0 and $600,000, thanks to Cornell University. I felt as a researcher that that was kind of a risky figure to use statistically. Levels of variance and all that sort of thing. So we set out to build a system that would demonstrate how much it costs to put a journal online. There was one slight problem. We didn't have a journal. But we went ahead anyway, and we built a system. And one of the young programmers that I had hired at a ridiculously low rate now, when I think back on it, told me that there was this open source software movement, that there was a spirit in which software was being shared, and that we shouldn't just build a system to test the notion how much does it cost in 1998 to put a journal online. We needed to build something in order to share it. And that the value of what we built, very eloquent student, the value of what we built would be in the sharing, in the understanding and use and facility that it provided, and that we should look for no other value. And that no matter what people did with our software, one of the big crisis moments for me was when they put on a subscription module and a PayPal module, but it was open source. It was to be shared, and others could build and extend on it. And that has a remarkable parallel to the quality of scholarly work. What is Crossref but a system that enables us to build on, to connect and share, to extend the work of others in a more efficient way? And so in that way, we need to understand that there are parallel developments, that open access is one strand of a larger opening within the sciences and humanities, the social sciences, and in fact, this larger information world, that people's expectations around knowledge are increasing, and we're playing one piece in it. So when you ask about impact factor, it's not just about scholars citing scholars. It's about the Wikipedia. Sorry, it's about Wikipedia. I always say that's not. It's about Wikipedia citing scholars. It's about the public uptake. It's about patients walking into doctor's offices and throwing down on the desk the latest studies that they've been able to find through PubMed or Medline Plus. The public impact of our work is going to be the significant development of the next decade, not increasing your impact factor by 0.0001 or whatever, how many three digits now it's being measured to. The impact factor, in terms of journals today, is going to be about Vietnam. In the last 18 months, thanks to the INASP group, 25, maybe close to 30 journals have gone from being not online to being online. The entire country, in terms of its scholarly output, that's probably an exaggeration, a good portion of the country came online. Its work is present. So the impact factor we need to think about is a global knowledge exchange that is being realized for the first time. The impact factor we need to think about is, what was this editor doing 5 years ago? What were the authors doing 3 years ago? Is this the first time any of them have reviewed an article? Is this the first time that this university has been able to publish something that the whole world has had access to? That's an impact factor. Not the New England Journal of Medicine going from 50 to 51 in its impact factor. So we need to see that the open access movement is part of something larger, part of something that we are contributing to by all means, but something that we are taking advantage of in terms of open access, in terms of open data, in terms of other developments, and something that we're contributing to in terms of this whole sense of information. And I say this as a school teacher. I say this as someone who spent a lot of time trying to teach children how to read, and they read anyway, in spite of my best efforts. I'd never really understood. In fact, if you ask me today, I'm still not sure how to teach a child how to read. I just do a lot of things in front of the child, and then the child starts to read, and I can't quite put my finger on it yet. But that sense that we're teaching a generation of students to have knowledge expectations, to have a sense of, where is the research? How come I don't have access to the knowledge that bears on my health or welfare or my family's health and welfare? Seems to me something that this group can begin to address, that part of the impact factor, part of the sustainability of open access is based on this larger public. Now, let me get into some of the points about the project I'm actually involved in, having preached enough, having done my little lecture. The Public Knowledge Project develops a software, Open Journal Systems, and it is being used, and there's an interesting question about the figure, because we don't really know. It's open source. People can download it. They don't have to tell us. But we're pretty confident that we're approaching 4,000 journals that are using the system around the world. That we have, and I have a number of stats I want to share with you in terms of the profile, because I think this is an unrecognized group. It is a group that is not in DOAJ, even though it is open access. It is a group that's not in Ulrich's. It is a group that is not in Scopus. It is a group that is not waiting for any indicators or badges or symbols of its quality or its sustainability. But it is plunging ahead, as in the case of Vietnam, which is also the journals there are using OJS. The software is open source, which means that you can freely download it without having to explain, without having to justify, without having to qualify. Are you good enough to start a journal? Does your institution provide enough resources? Are you committed to open access and to peer review? Well, it turns out, let me save the figures as a kind of a climax here. So we've built a system, and the intent of the system from the very beginning was to answer the question, remember the question? What does it cost to put a journal online? Stay with me, people. It's not going to be long. The answer for us was to reduce costs. The answer for us was to say there are no fixed costs in publishing. That it's not about sustaining revenue. It's about taking advantage of new technologies to reduce your costs. That there are different ways, as it were, in terms of business plans, of skinning the cat. And so we set out to automate as much as we could. We set out to reduce the costs, the clerical costs, the filing costs, the office maintenance costs of running a journal. So Open Journal Systems is a management, a workflow management system that enables editors to do their best editing on their way out to the airport and in the lounge before they get on the airplane, when they do most of their work. It enables them, through very simple automations like prepared emails, lists of reviewers and all of the things that they've done recently, so it's easy to select the reviewers, do matchups with the reviewers and the articles. It tracks all of the work that's being done. It dates everything. It maintains a flow in terms of where things are and what you need to do and when you need to do it. That's OJS. It's simple. You install it, and it works, apparently. We're probably at bug 4,221 today, so there have been a few ups and downs around it. But the notion is, and this is where the dangerous part is, that I've reduced the barrier for running a journal. I've created the illusion that it doesn't cost anything. Just sweat, inspiration, commitment to start a journal. And we've created the idea that starting the journal may lead to the collapse of the journal. But that the system itself is designed to be indexed. The system itself is designed to be sustainable in terms of its small space footprint for staying online. The system itself is designed to be hosted by the library, to be done in cooperation, because the thing, for me, that lies at the heart of a sustainability, of the sustainability of open access, is cooperation within the community. The library at Lund has been a model of that. And Lars made a very strong case for that in terms of what it means to contribute without any sense of where the financial returns would be in terms of the Directory of Open Access Journal. And a number of organizations have taken a similar kind of sense. So the idea that cooperation, the idea of tapping into other sources of support in terms of not financial support, but other sources of support in spirit, the open source software movement, open data, and others that I'll get to. The other thing that Open Journal Systems tries to do, is to build a system that takes care of some of the issues that journal editors certainly do face. So we have worked with Google Scholar around the indexing issue. We have built in, cross-reference support for DOIs. We have tried to build plugins and platform crossovers or bridges over to other systems in terms of that kind of cooperation. But we've also looked further at the automation. And we started to look at how the system itself can begin to improve the quality of the journal. Because even though I'm saying it doesn't take a kind of qualification in terms of quality to start a journal today, it takes a commitment, an interest, but not qualifications. We can still contribute to those. And so part of the work, and speaking to some of the earlier points, part of the work of Open Journal Systems, of OJS, has been to make explicit the kind of data the people are looking for. Is this peer-reviewed? What is the peer review policy? Who's on the board? What is the rejection rate of this journal? We've tried to make explicit all of the elements that are usually used to identify and to mark and judge journals. How does it fit in Google Scholar? Where are the citation levels for a journal like this that will not get into ISI? And most of our journals will not get into ISI, at least in the immediate short term. We've also looked at different ways of supporting two aspects. One is the scholarly side, just to take you on to the edge of things, in terms of where we're headed, the use of XML has become an exciting area for us. So XML is the way that we're moving forward. And through a young programmer named MJ Sahonis, I've seen some wondrous things happen. This ability not only to... let me put it this way. This ability to check references, that it will parse an article, and we've been doing this particularly in the area of medicine, but we plan to distribute it across all the areas. You feed it an article, and it automatically parses it into XML. It knows it's the title. It knows this is a paragraph. It recognizes a table. But then the wondrous thing for me is it gets into the bibliography. It gets into the bibliography, and it says, oh, this must be an author. Oh, here's a title. And over there is the journal title. Now, I have graduate students struggling with this, especially whether it's a comma after the title or a semicolon. I struggle with that. This not only parses it, it goes to PubMed and it looks it up and says, oh, New England Journal of Medicine, that's totally the wrong short form for that. And it corrects it. Not 100% of the time. It's called Lemonate, by the way. Lemonate doesn't correct it 100% of the time. It corrects it 80 to 90% of the time, and it spits out the ridiculous ones and says to the copy editor, come on, lend me a hand here. Throw me a bone. What is this journal? And so we go back to the author and we find out. But if it can do that, it can not only find corrections. Sorry, it can not only do the corrections, but it can also do other kinds of comparisons. What about the quotations? It can go onto the web and do a comparison on the quotations. Similar issue around the identification of authors. Are all of the authors cited? I don't know if this has ever happened to you. I would say 40% of the corrections I get back from copy editors are all about the bibliography. Because I cite people, and I'm proud of this, I cite people who don't even exist yet. I'm that far looking into the future. I know they will. And I want to be ready, and I think they should be born cited. And so part of the whole sense of how do we automate these systems to reduce the clerical and even the copy editing costs, and just reduce, not eliminate copy editing by any means. In fact, the system encourages copy editing because it only does a partial job and spits out what doesn't make sense to it. So that the people that matter in terms of scholarly quality, that is the author and the editor, have more time to work together on that quality. Now, as much as I put faith in the bibliography as a source of quality, and as much as I look first in the bibliography of any article I read, not only to find my own name, but for other reasons, the real quality is in the substance of the article. And the real quality should be derived from the relationship of the author to that knowledge, but just as importantly, the author and the editor. We all have that dream of that wonderful relationship between the author and the editor. The Raymond Carver, Thomas Wolfe kind of relationship with editors who make our work better and allow us to realize a sense of our own ability to write. So if we have a sense then that these systems are beginning to automate and reduce the costs, all I'm asking you to do when you think about your business plans, I'm not trying to discourage you from that, when you think about the feasibility and sustainability, think about ways in which you can reduce your costs. Think about ways in which you can use new tools and technologies, but just as importantly, think how you can contribute back to this community. What is the sustainability plan for Linux, for Apache? Microsoft will continue to contribute untold dollars through the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation? No, that's not the right answer. Linux is supported by a community of users who contribute code, who contribute bugs, and who feel a responsibility and a commitment to those contributions. So insofar as you are maintaining and working in your garden, insofar as you are breeding new types of pumpkins and tomatoes that can be harvested early in Canada, please. If you are engaged in that kind of work, see it as your responsibility to ask, how can I contribute this back? How can I work with other journals to develop tools that will improve the scholarly quality, that will reduce the cost by virtue of this distributed community, by virtue of the need for platforms, by virtue of a sense that it's only by cooperation among these different publishing types, commercial and nonprofit and scholarly society and independent, that we are going to continue to be able to publish at the level we want to publish. And so in that sense, you can begin to think about these different systems and the kind of experimentation that I'm suggesting you see as a responsibility and see that as a way to contribute back. Let me conclude with two other elements. One is the future in terms of further work that we're beginning to do, and that is to look at the monograph. Of all the problems I've contributed to, let me indulge myself for a moment here, the quality of journals, number one, and the proliferation, number two, a false economy sense that you can go ahead and not do a journal without any money, number three. The fourth sense is that the journal rules, that the journal is the full extent of human thought, that to think beyond the journal article is a bad investment in your intellectual time or, and energy. And there's a crime. There's a kind of criminal element there that we might begin to only think journal-length articles. And I have contributed to that because I've made the journal easier to start and use. And so I felt a responsibility, and that the Public Knowledge Project is currently engaged with Athabasca University, which is sitting here almost at team strength. I see Walter back there at least, and Kathy. That with Athabasca University Press, we are working on a monograph system that will do the similar kinds of things, only the difference this time is we're going to put them together. We're going to take a conference system and a monograph system and a journal system and create a common platform, like a university campus, only all out of the same material. It's one of the things you get when you go to Stanford. It's got to have the red roof. It's got to have the sandstone walls. It's a common basis, and we're going to do a shared platform because it's all about review. No, it's all about submission. It's all about distributing the work. It's all about review, whether it's a monograph or it's a conference or it's a journal. And that, in fact, there's a kind of flow through, whether it's the journal proceedings, the conference proceedings, or a journal that's going into book form. We're going to bring these together and try to build a common base, a common library of resources that people can begin to use to build the scholarly systems that work for them and can contribute back more easily, as well as to plug into other systems. We're going to try to begin to touch or tap into the social networking model. One of the things we've been playing with, and one of the principles that I've always operated under, is a fairly conservative one. And that is that it should look and smell and feel like a journal, because of the very issues that were raised around the authority, trust, provenance, respectability. And one of the things I've tried to do is hold to a kind of false but somewhat true philosophy. I'm only trying to change one thing. I didn't mess with peer review, didn't mess with open submissions. PLOS One is a much more experimental journal than I've ever worked with in terms of its policies. I stayed with one thing, and that is we're going to reduce the cost so you can increase access. But that's changing now. I think we can take a further step and begin to experiment with two or three things. So the idea that in the monograph we would have an incubation area, we would have an area where authors can begin to try their ideas before it's reject or accept. They can begin to open not just the review process, but the engagement and exchange. So more people are encouraged after the current recession. I mean the recession in terms of books, not General Motors. But the loss and the fear that those people, those scholars thinking about monographs now face. We need to nurture them back. We need to encourage them to think about their ideas in more than article length. Begin to think in terms of the size and scope of a book. So this idea of social networking, the other side of that will be at the other end. What about after publication? We need to think about the social networking, the post-publication. I don't know if you've had this experience or friends of yours have had this experience of publishing a monograph. Imagine a pond, pebble, rising, excitement, publication date, pebble, enters the pond, ripples outward. You know the story. We need a way to suspend and sustain that sense that the book is an ongoing cumulative contribution, and that ideas grow and are attracted to and linked to. So this is the post-pebble, cross-pebble, post-pebble publication notions. So there's still that sense of experimentation, and I'm glad after 10 years that I can step away from this notion that you only pretend to change one thing at a time. Let me briefly deal, you've been very patient, with who this is, because I think, and again, this is somewhat self-serving, but I think this represents an unknown community. We have a sample of 1,000 journals that most people don't know about. We have a sample of 3,000, close to 4,000 now. It's about 2 a day, the best we can tell, in terms of journals that are beginning to use OJS. What do those journals look like? This is what I want to share with you. These figures are so new. I was impressed by Bo's sense of trusting us. There were 25 bloggers in the room. You put up statistics and you say, do not quote. So 1975. That was great. I'm not going to show you the figures. I'm only going to say them. And if you don't see them on anything, you won't trust them. You won't record them, and they won't get transmitted. So we're just in the middle of this analysis. We sent out 2,700 invitations for people to respond. This is the first time we had ever contacted our journals. And I owe a certain nod to one of the youngsters who taught me about open source, excuse me, because he would never allow us to contact the journals. That was kind of a breach of trust. This is the only time we've done it, but we just had to know. And what did we learn? Well, 36% responded. That was really encouraging. I was ready to stop right there. But 48% of the journals, we're talking 1,000 journals in the response, but representing roughly 3,000 and 4,000 titles. 48% of these journals are in the developing world. 48% of these journals didn't have a hope. Well, that's not fair. 48%, let me do some more detail, but at least many of them are first-time ventures. And I would use Vietnam as a good example of that. The discipline is not too exciting. 60% in the sciences, 22% in the humanities, and again, this echoes earlier comments about this. In terms of publishers, who uses this free software? Well, not those engaged in competitive work. Only 3% are commercial enterprises that use our open source software. 30% are societies. But that leaves two-thirds are independent. Two-thirds represent this other force that I think is growing at a rate much greater than the commercial publishers are experiencing as quickly as they are growing or as rapidly as they're growing, and the scholarly societies, which have always been moving at a snail's pace. In terms of the history, who uses open source software? Who takes that risk of using open source software? Well, it's true. About 60% of them are 21st century journals. They decided, some 556 decided, perhaps because of OJS, but not entirely, I'm sure, to venture forth on the basis of OJS. But we have 5 journals from the 19th century. And I'm very proud of those 5 journals, including the oldest in Africa, the South African Medical Journal. We don't have Philosophical Transactions. We're still negotiating. That £50 is driving me, probably it's £50, not $50, driving me crazy. But at any rate, so we're getting some distribution. And in fact, 40% of the journals that use us are still in print. That is, they're using open source software, on the cutting edge, as it were, to go online. And I'll talk about whether it's open access in a moment. But 40% of them are continuing their print edition. And if you want to talk about economic models, the print is the critical decision. The print is the make or break in terms of budgets. Not all of them are open access. Our software is free. It now contains a PayPal subscription module for institutions, for memberships, for the usual types. And 10% of the users of our free software will not allow people to see their work, see the work they publish, excuse me, unless they have a password. But 80% are immediately open access. Now, if you begin to do the math, you'll see that there's going to be a little bit of drama around DOAJ, around the Directory of Open Access Journals and the inclusion of these journals, but I'll come to that as a final point. How much do they publish? 20% of them publish less than 10 articles a year at this point. That's not a credible journal. That's someone experimenting with publishing. That's someone who doesn't have enough time to really devote themselves to publishing. That's someone who's starting a journal and experimenting with this notion of peer review. And given the talk today, it hasn't been too good for that journal, but I want to defend that notion that academic freedom begins with those kinds of experiments when people start to break away from the big journals, break away from the respected titles that have a well-established publishing policy and direction and sense of what is right and what fits. But 10% of our journals, at least, publish more than 50 articles a year, which seems to me a respectable number. And in fact, in all of these figures, there's a kind of very level distribution. Take acceptance rates. 8% accept less than 20... this isn't going to work too well. It's too many percents in one sentence. Stay with me here. A small number, 8. A small number have a very low acceptance rate, 20%. And so a small number are hurting as many people's feelings as any of the major journals, just as effectively as journals that have, and many of the leading journals too, although more in the humanities. I know I was kind of touched by that. Came up more than once that the humanities are so, as it were, unaccepting. 14% of our journals have an acceptance rate higher than 80%, are accepting virtually everything. And again, are we responsible as platform providers? No, but we're interested. Do we see this as a problem? Well, not if we're concerned about global development of a knowledge exchange, not if we're concerned about people learning the ropes, beginning to establish a sense of scholarly communication that did not exist in their academic community prior to this. The review process. 85% have claim. 85% claim external peer review. That idea has established itself. That idea is kind of a baseline measure in terms of the scholarly journal. They may not publish very much. They may be accepting too many articles. But if 85% are engaged in peer review, that means that a much larger community is engaged in that critical, thoughtful process. That how do you learn to write an article? You review other people's articles. Any journal that contributes to the number of people who are engaged, the number of scholars engaged in review, and the vast majority are blind review, is contributing to the scholarly quality of the community. A review culture is what a journal is about. A review culture is what it fosters. And this ability to do that, I think, is a credit to these journals. But what about revenue? The question of fee-based. 9%. I did some of these stats just as we were sitting because it kept coming up. So how many journals using OJS? This is now, remember, the sample of 3,000 to 4,000 journals. Sorry, the sample's 1,000, but representing 3,000 to 4,000 journals. 9% of them are charging a fee. 33%, and this is the largest group, have a subsidy of some sort from their institution, from the government, from some body. That is, they have a patron. And we mustn't underestimate, in this medieval city, we mustn't underestimate the role of patronage and the scholar's privilege. And I want to hold to that. I want to hold to it in fair use, where it is enshrined. I want to hold to it in terms of the academic exception that allows me to own my copyright and not my institution. It takes my patents, but doesn't take my copyrights. I want to see that the academic work we do is a separate legal and economic domain. In terms of expenses, 50% of the journals that we're working with are operating at less than $1,000 a year. This is largely having to do with working in developing countries, but it's not entirely. They are working entirely, it's fair to say, I think, on volunteers, on commitment, on where most of the work happens. The core process for a peer-reviewed journal is the peer review, is a process that is freely contributed, which is edited, often by voluntary editors. And that process seems to be able to be done at a fairly reasonable rate. Final point, DOAJ. We are concerned about numbers, and I think it's fair enough, and I'm not here to criticize our use of numbers. But it's a very slippery game. It's a strangely odd game as a scholar. I was struck by Bo Krister's notion of the 33,000 was the title he presented on the board. Every time I see that, how many journals there are in the world, how many journals are being published today, I sit up. Because frankly, I'm embarrassed. This is my area of study. I'm in the School of Education, but I actually treat knowledge, access to knowledge, as an educational topic. I don't know if you can see it or not. My dean totally can't. Next week, I start preparing English teachers to teach Shakespeare, because she says, access to knowledge, what are you doing? You're in a school of education. So it's back to Shakespeare next week. So I'm concerned that when I'm stopped in security, and this has happened, and they ask me what I do, and I say, well, I study academic journals, and the security officer has asked me over the years a number of different questions. They haven't asked me this one, but I live in fear. Oh, yeah? You do? So, Mr. Vilinsky, how many journals are there? you know, take me away. It's between 25,000 and 50,000. Carol Tenapur, whose word I trust, is at 50,000, and Stephen Harnert at 24,000. It's hard to know. So DOAJ is a figure we use all the time. Over 4,000 open access journals. And I was kind of surprised when we did the stats on our figures, because only 18% of our journals are in DOAJ. That means there are 1,968 journals that are open access using OJS that aren't in DOAJ. That means perhaps 50%. The figure of 4,000 is off by perhaps close to 50%, or under 50%, I should say. And that the sense of how many journals are out there, how many journals are open access, how many articles are available, is this kind of amorphous, slippery aspect. And at some point, we have to embrace that. At some point, we have to say that the world is opening, and that it's not about open access, it's about increased access. It is about more knowledge being out there and more people having to make critical decisions about that knowledge and judgments. And we can support that, those judgments. But we can't control them. We can't contain them. We can say that something important is happening, at least something important for those of us committed, whether to education or to scholarship, in terms of scholarly communication. But it's not something that we'll be able to put a badge on. Thank you very much.
So we are a little late, but I think it's worth leaving time for questions. If you guys need to run, feel free to do so. But we'll take a few questions.
Hi. I have just one. Well, I have many questions, but the first question will make it possible to have other questions. Is OJS cross-platform? I work daily on the Mac, and my graphic designer works on the Mac. Can I use it on a Mac, or do I
Yes, you can load it on a Mac.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, then I have many other questions, but I'll ask you.
Nothing more technical than that. That's all I can answer.
I think I heard you mentioned open data access.
Yes.
But you didn't give any detail about
no.
that.
No, so very good. So can I jump in?
Yes, that's okay.
Yeah, so we're going to work with Dataverse Network. Let me recommend Dataverse Network. Dataverse Network addresses the question. This is a group led by Gary King at Harvard. Dataverse Network addresses the question, why would you put your data up on the web? And Dataverse Network provides an answer. You will get your data cited before your article is cited. You will have the data in a form that is citable and traceable. It will be preserved and it will be available to others, and it will have metadata associated with it. Doesn't give you kind of a chill down your spine? It will have metadata associated with it, and you will be able to see the number of citations it has. And so we have had, in OJS, we have had a data deposit section called supplementary files since from the very beginning. And it has been used, I don't know, no one's ever told me it's been used. And so we think the incentive notion, the idea that we can provide a secure home, that it is properly, as it were, indexed by this metadata, and that it is citable, is an approach we need to take. Because the issue, and we've seen this with GenBank and many others, the leading journals now require, in medicine, biomedical publishing require the deposit in GenBank if it's related to the genome. We've seen that there have been a number of different ways of punitive or prescriptive or required, and we're looking at other ways of trying to provide incentives. And we think the citability, and I invite you to have a look because it's an interesting problem. So we're building a plugin, we're building a kind of cross-platform with Dataverse Network because it is an important issue. We do see that as contributing as much to the quality of science as open access, open data, replicability, reproducibility.
Can I just add I didn't know that you were working also with Dataverse, but I just want to add the fact that Dataverse also warranty the fact that the data that are deposited cannot be changed.
Yes, right. And it has a thumbprint where it can trace it, and people take your data and don't cite you, that you can hunt them down. data hunters. You have data miners? You watch an airport, you'll see data hunters.
Do we have any other questions? Okay, then join me in thanking John.